Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this glorious day that we don't have to worry about daylight savings time. Yeah, I came from over 50 years of dealing with daylight savings time. This is the first time I haven't really had to deal with it. I'm really excited about it. So welcome, welcome. So glad that you could be with us. A special welcome to those of you who may be new. We're so glad that you joined us as well. And as we do each week, we always invite those who are new to fill out one of these welcome cards. It's there in the seat in front of you. And put that in the box and just let us know how we can, any questions that we can answer for you and your information. We would love to connect with you. And so thank you for doing that. Also, if you brought an offering today, thank you so much for your partnership in the ministry of this church. You can place that in the offering box on the way out in the center aisle or over here on this side, and we appreciate that. If you have prayer cards or communication cards, you could put those in there as well. Special shout out to those of you who may be with us online, and we're glad that you could join us as well. Today we will be offering Holy Communion in the service today, and so you do not need to be a member of American Lutheran to receive Holy Communion, just a believer in Jesus, and we would love to welcome you to that. We also have a great prayer team that is happy to pray with you each Sunday, and there's a place over on the side over here where you can see a sign that says personal prayer. Just go over to that area and someone with a prayer team lanyard will join you for prayer. Couple things to mention. Today at 9 o'clock, Axel Funk from our church is going to start a new study called Why I Am a Christian. And if you know Axel, he's just got a great story, a great love for Jesus, and that's going to be downstairs, and it's going to be going for the next several weeks. Also, the Mothers of Preschoolers are offering a little fundraiser downstairs as well, so go check that out. The Christmas season is just around the corner, and we always celebrate with the Yule Fest here at American Lutheran. Before that concert is what we call Madrigal Dinner, and it is going to be a magical Madrigal Dinner. So you don't want to miss out. There are tickets that you need to purchase, and there is a limited seating, so I want to encourage you to do that. It's going to be Saturday, December 9th. And the dinner's at 4:30 with a concert to follow, and so make sure you check that out as well. We're entering into the fall, which is kind of a stewardship emphasis and reminder time period, and our stewardship focus this year is the words, picture this. And the words picture this is just giving us the reminder to think about and picture what God is doing and will do through our congregation. There's an esteemed person who put together a video today to kind of highlight that. Let's take a look at that right now. Good morning, American Lutheran peeps. I'm standing out here in front of our church sign and building because this is the launching place that God has us to do ministry in this community. We are in this time and place to proclaim the love and grace of Jesus Christ in our community and in our world. This year, we're using the phrase, picture this, as our stewardship focus. Our hope is that every person in our congregation will picture what God is doing in and through our church. Here are some glimpses. Youth and family ministry is always an important emphasis in our church. We are called to train up our children and families to love and serve God. We are so blessed to have Leah Munoz and her team who head up our ministries to our children and our families. From Vacation Bible School to children's ministry each week, Mothers of Preschoolers to events like the Family Fun Fest, American Lutheran is a place for our children to grow in the Lord. In our family ministry, Vicar Christian and Madeline and their team are in the process of redeveloping our junior and senior high ministry youth group. I'm also involved in teaching confirmation weekly, and then our junior hires meet with the rest of the youth group at The Rock for a great time of worship, teaching, and ministry. Our vision
is to continue to build relationships for our teenagers that they would grow to love Jesus and to serve Him. We're excited about what God's doing, and we know that God will do great things in the days to come. Next week, we're going to talk about outreach opportunities at American Lutheran. Remember that Sunday, November 19th, is Celebration Sunday, where we will all have an opportunity to picture what God is doing in and through our church, through our investments in our time, our talents, and our financial treasures. Together, we'll continue to do the work of building the kingdom of God here in this community. I look forward to serving with you. God bless.
Thank you, Pastor Mark. Wow. Hopefully you received a letter that we sent out this week, encouraging everyone to be intentional about how they are going to take what God has given to us and to use it to build His kingdom. And so November 19th will be a special Sunday where we will be able to kind of re-up, and so to speak, in how we are going to share our time, our talents, and our treasures. Also wanted to mention that today is the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. And this afternoon, we're going to show a video of a book that was written by a pastor and his wife, Pastor Richard Vermbrandt and his wife, Sabina, who back in the 40s and 50s were persecuted in Romania for their faith. And he wrote a book and actually founded a ministry called Voice of the Martyrs. The movie is called Tortured for Christ. It does have some difficult scenes in it, so if you're sensitive to that, that may be something to consider. But we would love to have everyone come out and be a part of that as we both watch the movie. I think it's about an hour, and then we'll have some time of talking and prayer for the persecuted church today. So it starts at 4 p.m. this afternoon in the Fellowship Hall. So if you would like to come be a part of that, it's free, and we would love to have you come and be a part of that. With that, let's take some time to pray. Lord, You have called us to be Your people. And Lord, we don't get to choose the time that we're born. We don't get to choose the place that we're born, but we get to choose how we live in the place that we are. Lord, we realize and recognize and lift up those in other parts of the world who are in very persecuted places. We ask that You would give them grace and determination, that You would fill them with courage to stay true to You and to Your word. And may we, in our own times of challenge and difficulty, even persecution, be faithful to You in everything. Lord, we can't do it without You. So, Holy Spirit, we ask that You would fill us again. May this time of worship be a time of enriching, deepening of our understanding of You and how we can live out the word that You've given to us. And so we pray for Your blessing upon this time of worship as together we lift up Your name, which is the name of Jesus, who died and rose again in our behalf. Thank You, Lord. Amen. With that, I invite you to stand and greet those around you as we begin our time of worship together.
All Saints' Day celebration has been a long history in the worship life of the Christian Church. It began as a commemoration of the martyrs who had died for their faith, and it has since become a day when we honor and remember those who, in death, have joined the Church triumphant, as well as the faithful saints of the present who serve Jesus Christ. Martin Luther held that all Christians are simultaneously sinner and saint, a sinner because of our rebellious nature, but a saint because of salvation in Jesus. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in those image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved.
Amen.
Holy God, all glory belongs to you. We come to you in prayer to glorify your name, not because of what you do, but because of who you are. We adore you for being our Abba Father. Your unconditional love for us stretches to the highest mountain peaks and reaches to the depths of the seas. It is beyond anything we can fathom. Your love never ends, and your great is faithful. Hear us as we lift to you our transgressions. Open our hearts and minds to where we have gone astray, and let us confess to you in this time of silence. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides our beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our name. Open our hands to serve your creation. Hear the good news, friends. We are God's children, and Jesus opens the door to us. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, we are forgiven.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. The first reading is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 7. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where do they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The second reading is from 1 John. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Please stand.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Praise you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and began to teach them, and he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Amen. You may be seated. Lord in heaven, as we gather today around your word, as we are here in this place, Lord, we want to hear from you. Lord, these are the words that you spoke from the message of the Sermon on the Mount, a message that awoke, challenged, and penetrated the hearts and the lives of those who first experienced your presence. Lord, we want to experience your presence today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So, how many of you remember this guy? Anybody know who that is? Yes, it was Yuri Gagarin. Gagarin? I wasn't alive when he was around. I know, you want to kill me now. But he's the first spaceman. He's the one who actually orbited the Earth in the challenge between the Soviet Union and the United States to who would have a space dominance. And he was the first one who actually orbited the Earth and was the first spaceman. And he has a famous saying that when he orbited the Earth, he looked out, which had to be an amazing experience, not just to be the first, but I mean to just be out there in space. Anybody remember what he said? "I looked out and I didn't see God." Couldn't see God. Traveled all the way around the world. Didn't see any evidence of God. Of course, he comes from an atheistic perspective in the culture that he lived in. But many people, especially a person named Dr. Criswell, replied, Well, if he were to just take one step outside of his space capsule, he would have a quick meeting with God. It's interesting. We look for God, but do we find God? Well, the Bible promises if we are truly willing to seek him, we will find him if we seek him with all our heart. It's interesting that every breath that we take, every movement that we make, the Bible says we live and move and have our being in God. And yet, there are many who conclude that God is nowhere to be found. But the promise in God's word is, if we seek him, we will find him. Isaiah 55, verse 6 says this, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon." And then God says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." God is everywhere present. And if we're missing it, it's likely that we either are not seeking or we don't want to find it. Uri didn't find it because he couldn't see with spiritual eyes. Well, today, Jesus speaks this powerful and amazing message, beginning what's known as the Sermon on the Mount. He's in the Sea of Galilee area. Crowds are gathering around, and Jesus has them all park themselves on the hillside, and he begins to teach. And he begins to say some words that give us insight into how we can find God, where we can find God. We do not come to God on our terms, but we come to God on his terms. And so when we're looking for God, we can find God unbelievably and amazingly in these different places. First, we find God in humility and brokenness, not in human arrogance and hubris. In humility and brokenness. Jesus says again in Matthew 5, verse 1, "When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down, and his disciples were with him, and he began to teach them, and he said, 'Blessed, in good shape, in good form,'" that word blessed means, "are the" what? "Poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who..." Really? Have you been through a time of mourning? Have you lost a loved one? Have you lost a job? Have you lost the ability to do something? Have you been through mourning? Do you feel blessed? What are you talking about, Jesus? And he goes on from there to say, "Blessed are the meek." We often associate that word meek with the word weak. In the kingdom of heaven, it's just the opposite. The humble, the meek, the broken, they will be comforted. They will be filled. They will be blessed. God blesses us when we recognize our brokenness, when we recognize our need for him. I think Uri and others throughout the world who have said, "I can't find any evidence for God," come because they think they have it all together. They have it all figured out. Take one step outside your space capsule, though. You'll find out how much you don't have it figured out. Amen? God blesses those who will humble themselves, recognize their need. The poor in spirit, the broken who are mourning, the meek, those who are humble. Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter chapter 5. He says, all of you, clothe yourselves in humility toward one another, because God, what? Opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, and he will what? He will lift you up. You want to be put down? Come with arrogance. You want to be lifted up? Come with humility. God blesses those who recognize their need for him. And he fills us with an ability, one, to receive his amazing grace and be set on course for a destiny with him. If we think that we have it all figured out, we lose. We lose his presence. What was the original temptation that the serpent gave to Eve in the garden? You will what? You will be like God. In the beginning, God created human beings in his image. Ever since then, human beings have been trying to create God in our image. We want to be able to control him. We want to be in control of our life. And God says, no. Come to me in humility and recognize that I will take care of you. The heart of the message of the gospel that Jesus read when he first began his ministry came straight out of Isaiah 61, verse 1, where it says, "The Spirit of the sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. And they will be called what? Oaks of righteousness." I love that term. Oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord. For what reason? To display his splendor. God has been and is about doing a work of restoration. Do you feel broken today? Where are you mourning? What is causing you to realize, I don't have it all figured out? Jesus says, if that's where you are, oh, you are blessed, because my Father in heaven is going to do a work of restoration in you. It's fall time, right? Time of all the critters gathering nuts for the winter, right? Not quite as crazy here as it is back in Minnesota where I grew up. But one of the things they love to do is gather the acorns, right? In every acorn is the possibility of becoming a majestic tree. You will be called oaks of righteousness. And you look at the acorn and you go, how can that become majestic? Jesus said, unless a seed goes into the ground and dies, it will never become more than just a seed. But if it does, God does a work. Are you in a place of brokenness? Give it to Jesus. He is doing a work that your life would become a place to display his splendor. We find God in our humility and in our brokenness. Jesus goes on to teach us that we find God in truth and mercy. "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy." We live in a time and an era where we don't have tooth decay, we have truth decay, amen? And the question really comes down to, where do we find truth? A lot of people say, well, truth is subjective. It's your truth. It's your, and I get, we have our own experience with truth. But truth is not subjective. Truth and righteousness come from God. Do we hunger for righteousness? Do we hunger for purity? Do we hunger for what is good? What is healthy? What is whole? Or do we continue to consume that which is broken? Jesus said, blessed are you when you hunger and thirst for what is right. And I think it's very interesting that the next phrase speaks against what we often end up as good church folk, right? We hunger and we thirst for righteousness, right? Oftentimes so that we can become self-righteous, judgmental. Oh, look at those terrible people over there. Look what they're doing. The Word of God is never intended to be a place where we proclaim our judgment on the world. It's intended to be a mirror so that we can reflect on how God's truth is speaking to us. Because then it goes on to say, blessed are those who are merciful, those who are graceful, those who recognize the brokenness in others because we recognize the brokenness in ourselves. You want to find God? Find His truth in His Word, but not as a means to point out everybody else's faults, but to recognize our own. When we hunger and we thirst for righteousness, God promises will be filled. When we are merciful, when we are graceful, we recognize the grace that we ourselves need as well. We find God in truth and mercy. Jesus said this, Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, but seek first His kingdom, His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Where are we seeking truth? Where are we seeking righteousness? Social media? The news? Or do we take time to say, Lord, speak to me in your word? We need the Lord to fill us with His truth. Jesus goes on from there in the next verses to talk about that we find God as we seek peace and purity. Matthew chapter 5, verse 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. There's so much discontinuity. There's so much, so many things that divide us. Do we look, when we look at other people, when we look at our quote-unquote enemies, do we see that they are first and foremost created in the image of God? That our fight is not against flesh and blood, but it is against the evil one, the rulers, the principalities, who bear up arms against all that is good, all that God loves. Do we recognize God? Humans are not the problem. It is the evil one who has caused that veil to be drawn over our eyes that we cannot see God. Do we pray, Lord, open our eyes to see the grace and the mercy that you want to do in the life? Do we seek peace? I love what Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 18. If it is possible, as far as what? It depends on you. There are things that are not possible because they're beyond our ability to control. But as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone, because peace provides the means by which we can communicate the love and the grace of Christ. And then finally, Jesus goes on to tell us that we find God especially in times of trouble and persecution. Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 goes on to say, blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness, For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. God does a work, especially in times of trouble and persecution. Last week, we read Martin Luther's favorite psalm. I'm going to read first for a few verses with you again. Psalm 46, verse 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very what? Present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. I know we live in a time that is extremely troubling, but we need to remember God has been and continues to be in control. I know we look at the news and we see the lives that are devastated, but God is very present in those places. And Jesus says, I need you to look beyond the suffering. I need you to look beyond the persecution. I need you to look beyond it so that you can know I'm at work through it. Today is the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. Milton, Linda Hansen, who belong to our church, who were missionaries in Romania and know the terrain of where Pastor Richard Wurmbrandt and his wife Sabina lived and served, and the environment, sent us out this document that talks about persecution. It says, more than 360 million Christians worldwide suffer high levels of persecution and discrimination for their faith. That's a staggering 1 in 7 believers. Persecution can take many forms, often in different communities, and being ostracized, losing homes, losing even their life through imprisonment, through torture, and through death. We are called to pray. And what's interesting is when you talk to those who are in those persecuted situations, most often they don't ask that you pray that they would be released from it. What they are asking for is prayer for the strength to stand up under it. And I think we pray for them. We also pray for ourselves, because folks, I don't know what our situation is going to be in the next year, the next 5 years, the next 10 years. I think it's going to increasingly be more challenging to be a believer. However, how exciting to say Jesus is going to use those things to build his kingdom. And so I say we pray for them. We also pray for ourselves, that in our own situations of persecution, of trouble, we would keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. So just to close out this time, I want to pray with you for these special ways that these believers ask that they be prayed for. So let's pray together. Lord in heaven, we pray for the persecuted church. We pray, Lord, for a spirit of boldness and wisdom for handling difficult situations. We pray that you would strengthen them and embolden them to stand true. Lord, we pray according to your word to be strong in you and in your mighty power, to put on the whole armor of God, that we would be able to stand against the schemes of the devil, for our fight is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and forces of the evil one. Lord, we pray that those who are persecuted would be reminded that in all things we are conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would also use their testimonies and their opportunities to share the gospel with their neighbors. I pray that you would give them a spirit of encouragement, that they would not be discouraged. We pray, Lord, that they would also be a comfort to those around them as they are comforted by you. As it says in 2 Corinthians 1, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, because he comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort others in their troubles with the comfort we have received from God. And Lord, we pray that you would give your power and reminder. As you say in your word in John 14, very truly I tell you, everyone who believes in me will do the works that I have been doing. They'll do even greater things than these because Jesus said he was going to you, the Father. Lord, we pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we could live our lives for you. Give us strength not to run away from persecution, but to be able to stand up under it. Teach us, Lord, to have humble hearts, that times of struggle are times of refining and blessing for us. We pray, Lord, that we would hunger and thirst for what is good and what is right, that not to be judgmental, but to have mercy. Lord, we pray for purity. We pray for peace. We pray for your grace upon our world in these troubled days. Lord, shine through by the power of raising up your kingdom in and through us and the people who believe in you around the world. In Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. I invite you to stand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of the ages, we give you thanks for saints, those of our day and of days before,
who
who nurtured us in faith, who told us the stories of Jesus, and who cultivated among us the sense of our own vocation to follow God's path. Help us not only to remember them, but also to follow their example, to nurture their expectant hope, and to live our lives so that others might see your love reflected in all that we say and do. Thank you, God, for the gift of your saints. God of all time, we praise you for all your servants, saints who have gone before us this year. Kenneth Conkey, Wallace Cole, Donovan Fletcher, June DeBeale, Dorothy Gresseth, Larry Ellis, Gustav Erickson, Stan Steiner, Donald Dale, Dorothy Smith, Keith Rupert, Floyd Petzold, Bob White, James Dixon, Jack Cronenberry, Jean Isom, we acknowledge people who have served as saints in our own lives, parents, teachers, mentors, and friends who have challenged us to be all God created us to be. We now call out the names of our own saints. Today, we also remember with thanksgiving saints alive who continue to touch our lives and our faith journey. And we look ahead with hope to the people whose faithful witness to God's love will inspire future generations. God of refuge and strength, you are our stronghold in times of trouble. In the midst of chaos and strife, quiet our anxious hearts and help us center our minds to take captive every thought in obedience to your will. Help us to cease looking at what is wrong in the world and instead reflect on the many blessings that you pour into us daily. May our gratitude through prayer and praise for all you do be a visible sign to others that we receive our hope in you, and that you are the life-giving source for all who seek you. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the friends and family of Jean Isom, who has joined the saints in heaven. We ask for health and well-being to be with Danny Lurberg, who has been hospitalized, as well as for all those we name silently in our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy. We often feel as if this world's problems are more than we are able to bear. Help us to remember that all things work together for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. Grateful for your love, Lord, we ask that you pour out your Spirit on all who are being persecuted around the world. Send your army of angels to protect them from those who seek to destroy your precious children. Embolden all of your saints to make a difference and bring you glory through the kingdom work you have called us to do. Lord, in your mercy, keep us grateful for the witness of the saints of all generations and make us like them, eager to follow in the way of Christ. Then at the last, bring us with them to share in the inheritance of the saints of life. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that they may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, singing,
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. It's been given for you." In the same way, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat the bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forevermore. Hear us now as we pray the prayer that our resurrected Lord taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good.